F1 on ITV, sponsored by LG.
Good afternoon. On race day, Silverstone has to be just about the busiest airport in the world. Those air traffic controllers really have their hands full, coping with some 1,500 helicopter movements over a hectic 14-hour period. And down below, it is a magnificent sight. It's a beautiful July afternoon. We have a 100,000 sellout for the Foster's British Grand Prix. There is massive home support for Jenson Button, and he's stuck the BAR on the front row. Louise Goodman was waiting when Jenson turned up for work this morning.
Morning, gents, how are you doing?
Not bad, thank you. On this beautiful sunny morning.
Fantastic, isn't it? Sunshine at Silverstone, front row of the grid. Doesn't get much better than that, does it?
It would do, I think, if we won the race today. But we'll see. I think it's going to be a great day. I'm looking forward to it.
Packed crowd out there, and obviously a large percentage of them are going to be cheering for you. I think they could have something to cheer about as well.
Let's not talk up too much, but I can say that I'm looking forward to the race. Being P2 is fantastic here in front of the home crowd, and we've got beautiful weather for it, which is going to help us as well. The hotter it is, the better it is for our car. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to it, and I think that our team can do a very good job this weekend.
We'll be watching out for you.
Thank you.
Before the red lights go out, there's more from Jenson Button. Maybe, just maybe, he'll hit the jackpot. Michael Schumacher refuses to surrender his title. He talks exclusively to ITV F1. Martin Brundle's been going up in the world, courtesy of the fabulous Red Arrows.
What a great ride that was for Martin. I've come down to Earth as well, to the BRDC, the British Racing Drivers Club, here in the centre of Silverstone. Throughout the weekend, Formula One has been going about its business, ever mindful of everyone touched by the tragedy in London. We have seen flags at half-mast. Some of the teams are making their own gestures, like Jordan racing today with blackened nose cones. Security has been tightened as well. The capacity crowd cooperating fully with the police and circuit officials. Well, before the start of the Grand Prix, there will be a minute's silence involving the drivers and the team principals. We aren't expecting to see any champagne on the podium either. Well, in just a moment, Martin Brundle will take you around Silverstone with Jenson Button. Before that, here is James Allen with his thoughts on qualifying.
While one half of the McLaren garage had dramas with Raikkonen's engine change, Juan Pablo Montoya did a great job with this lap, despite going out early. It was enough for fourth, which became third, once Raikkonen took his 10-place penalty. David Coulthard has won this race twice for McLaren, but this weekend his Red Bull Cosworth was suffering from an electrical glitch on the gear shift. It meant he lost out to Villeneuve and Webber, whom he thought he could beat. DC 13th on the grid. Jarno Trulli continued his run of form with a net fourth on the grid, and his race pace looks stronger than at Magny-Cours last week, so he's unlikely to hold the field up as he did in France. Jenson Button and BAR keep improving their package, and here Jenson opted once again for the tactic of running slightly lower fuel to get track position. It was one of his best ever qualifying laps, and it looked like pole. Michael Schumacher hung it all out on his lap. Ferrari looks stronger here than in France with the new Bridgestone tyre. Rubens Barrichello is fifth on the grid, while Schumacher opted to carry a little bit more fuel, and he took ninth. Knowing he would drop 10 places from wherever he qualified, Raikkonen put extra fuel in the car and went on the attack. It was a sensational lap, and although he drops to 12th, he will challenge Alonso for the victory today. The World Championship leader expected to be outclassed by Raikkonen here at Silverstone, so he's the chief beneficiary of the Finn's engine problems. Once again, he stood up in the seat in qualifying with a virtually perfect lap to snatch his fourth pole of the year and spoil Button's homecoming parade.
Well, qualifying yesterday was truly dramatic, and one of the interesting things about it is that none of the big names let themselves down. They all did a superb job, and for me that sets the stall on what should be a Grand Prix of excellence here this afternoon. We've got several races going on here at once. Obviously, Fernando Alonso off the pole knows that Montoya will be a huge threat this afternoon, and he also knows that Raikkonen has the speed here at Silverstone that he didn't have in France last weekend to come through the field and challenge him at the end. Jenson Button, Jarno Trulli, they're all in the hunt for a podium slot. It should be fast and furious stuff here at Silverstone this afternoon.
It's not really bad luck, it's a bad preparation, and just need to, whoever's fault it is, so everybody needs to work harder and make sure that those things doesn't happen.
The car has been very quick, it's been very consistent. All the long runs we've done is, you know, same lap time over and over again. The question is if that lap time is quick enough.
To get Jenson in the first row and hopefully tomorrow fight for the race, I think is the best news for all the English people. Also, because what happened in London in the last week, I think they deserve this big news.
Nice lap, Jenson. Let's take a look at it on board with you and a look at the lap. Contemplating before the start, what's going through your mind?
The same as always, really. Just trying to be nice and relaxed, thinking about getting heat into the tyres. Especially around here, we've really struggled to get some heat into those tyres.
Really? So that's a bit of a shock then when you head down to Copse for the first lap?
Yeah, down one gear into Copse here, and a little bit of understeer in the car through there. We've suffered with that a little bit this weekend, haven't really got rid of it.
Look at the turn-in speed. This is an act of blind faith, isn't it, into Beckett's that it's going to stick?
It is. You've got two flat-out corners, which is Maggots, and you're into Beckett's. But you've just got to be careful not to push too hard because you do screw the exit and you lose that speed down that long straight.
What are you looking and thinking about now?
I'm just not trying to be as relaxed as possible. I'm looking at my split times I've got on the dash. Through slow there, a little bit of understeer in the car, but I was really confident with the car that the rear was going to stay stuck. That's why I was able to brake so late into club there.
You kept a nice wide entry though, gave you a nice easy straight line out and up then to Abbey.
Yeah, at this point I'm feeling pretty pleased with myself actually, but I'm not obviously still not forgetting that there's half a lap to go. But the car's feeling good, and it's just about being as consistent as I possibly can through the lap.
Now watch a full throttle through bridge. Look how wide you are there.
Yeah, this is my favourite sector here. This is where I was quickest in qualifying. But I don't know why other people don't do it. I mean, it's just using a bit of extra circuit, and I'm able to get the car in a little bit better into the corner and carry the speed.
Were the tyres fading towards the end?
Not at all. They're consistent throughout the lap. There's a new bit of tarmac in the last corner, which gives you a nice bit of grip coming onto the straight there. But when I crossed the line, I was so happy because I couldn't have got anything else out of the car.
This is a natural reaction, isn't it?
Yeah, and I was just buzzing.
What did you say underneath the crash helmet there?
I had the radio on. And they said that I just made a loud noise. They weren't sure what it was. It sounded like an animal in pain.
You're surely going to be thinking a podium.
Yeah, I mean, it's not impossible, but it's possibly one of the most difficult podiums to fight for because we've got the Renault at the front of Alonso. We've got Montoya, and we've got Kimi, who still has a chance of fighting for a podium. So it's going to be tough, but I'm really excited. I'm really, really can't wait to get out there.
And we cannot wait to see him either. He is buzzing. He's been screaming like an animal in the cockpit. Give us the hard-nosed ex-F1 driver's view. Can he do it?
Yeah, I think today's going to be very difficult for him to win this Grand Prix. Unless you see something go wrong with maybe Alonso at the front, it's possible. But I think Jensen's got a great opportunity putting himself on a podium, and I think second place is on the cards.
Tony, this is fantastic here today. We mustn't forget, for a long time, we wondered whether we were going to be here for the British Grand Prix.
Of course, there was a lot of doubt, and the international colleagues, our media coming through London, etc., came in and said, surely you can't have a Grand Prix. We followed the general mood of the country, that we're carrying on with things, albeit in a sombre mood, and we've got this 100,000 sellout crowd. We've got an absolutely brilliant day. The crowd are absolutely loving it. They're really up for it.
We could have a great race. Kimi Raikkonen is bound to be involved in it, but that engine change has cost him dear again.
Yeah, it was an oil pump that went this time, and for the second time in two races, he had to go for it. But if you look at the three races from San Marino, including, where they've lost the points, they lost a potential 22. If they'd had that, and Alonso, assumingly, had finished second, he'd be 4 points ahead in the championship now.
Yeah, they've got to change the regulations, though. They must penalise constructors. They can't keep penalising the drivers' championship. They've got to do something with that.
Fernando Alonso agrees with you, I'm sure, about that. What do you make of Michael Schumacher, a sort of supermarket car park shunt with his fellow German Nick Heidfeld?
Well, it's definitely an insurance job, Jim. I don't know what was going on there with Michael. I don't know whether he was doing it on purpose, just to give him a little nudge. He may have upset him out in the circuit, or whether he just clearly got his judgment wrong. But it's not the kind of thing we expect from him.
You know this place well. We get great excitement, and we have had big accidents too. Witness Jarno Trulli last year in the Renault.
It's a horrendous accident. Coming out of bridge corners, 170 miles an hour on the exit of that turn there. You see the car turning over, the impact from the barrier, everything comes off the car. That's normal, we're expecting that. But Jarno a little bit shaken up. The doctor there, a little bit overambitious with the way he pulls him away. He's probably clearly got a headache with that one. But, you know, Renault had a suspension failure. Let's hope they don't have it again.
Truly going well in the Toyota this season. Overtaking, we love to see the overtaking here. Remember, was it Barrichello and Raikkonen a couple of years ago?
But that's the potential that we have today. You know, if Kimi can come through the field and get up with Alonso and Schumacher, etc., this is what we could have. And this was after the safety car. We lost count of the overtaking manoeuvres, and finally Barrichello got to go inside and outside of Kimi, and through he came like that. It was breathtaking. We could be in for that today.
Let's hope so. Tony, it's another pole for Alonso, for Renault and for Michelin. Just chat us through the grid.
Alonso's fourth pole of the season, but for Button, the weight of British expectation with his best Silverstone start in second. And season's best for Montoya third, fourth, Trulli's fast Toyota, fifth, 2003 winner Barrichello, sixth, Fisichella's Renault, 1.1 seconds behind Alonso, seventh, Takuma Sato, eighth, Ralf Schumacher, ninth, Michael Schumacher struggling with incorrect tyre pressures, 10th, Villeneuve Sauber, 11th, Mark Webber for Williams, 12th, Kimi Raikkonen qualified second, demoted 10 for an engine change. He has to do it all over again. 13th, Coulthard, his worst ever Formula One grid at Silverstone. 14th, Heidfeld. 15th, Kleon. 16th, Massa. 17th, Kartikeyan in the Jordan. 18th, Christian Albers. And 19th, Friesackers in the Minardi. 20th, Montero after an engine change penalty. Expect an electric start with all eyes on Button at the front and Kimi charging through the field.
Well, Arsene Wenger, welcome to Silverstone. Have you had a good look around the place and had a look in the garages?
Yes, I'm quite surprised how open it is to people, because the race starts in half an hour and everybody walks around the cars, and it's quite amazing.
Other than that, any other surprises?
The weather first and the number of people who are in there. It's I know that the English are great motor racing fans, and I'm not surprised that there are so many people here.
What do you think you'd be like at running a Formula One team?
I'm not very good, because I have very few knowledge about the motors and the engines. But it's interesting to see the atmosphere before the race, and how well it is organised all, and how clean it is all here.
Now, Toyota have a budget of about £200 million a year to spend on their cars. What could you do at Arsenal with that kind of money?
A lot more, because football clubs now are half of that, and even a third of that. So you could imagine how much more you could do with it.
Enjoy your day. Thanks for talking to
you. You too. Bye-bye.
He would take that budget. Dennis Bergkamp here last year. Arsene Wenger, this, the Gunners love their F1. We always want your input. To email us at paddock@itv-f1.com. I urge you to sample our website, itv.com/F1, and Martin's your man on this week's Ask the Team. We have a competition every Grand Prix weekend. The Williams drivers, Webber and Heidfeld, are standing by after Ted Kravitz has given you the answer to our Manny Coeur question.
Well, last week we gave three lucky people the chance to win £1,000 worth of quality Eden Park merchandise. And the winners who knew that Manny Coeur hosts the French Grand Prix are Raymond Hearn from Wigan, Glenn Coulter from Stranraer, and John Knight from King's Lynn. Well, now you've won the shirts off our backs, it's an opportunity to win some of the driver's gear. Mark, what can they win?
Well, they can win this shirt signed by myself and Nick, which is obviously incredible. We've got two to give away, and they can also win a fantastic behind-the-scenes tour at the Williams factory, courtesy of RBS.
OK, for the question, Mr. Nick Heidfeld?
Yeah, in 55 years, which circuit has hosted the most British Grand Prix? Is it A, Silverstone, B, Brands Hatch, or C, Aintree?
Thanks, Nick. That question again. Which circuit has hosted the most British Grand Prix? Is it A, Silverstone, B, Brands Hatch, or C, Aintree? To enter, call 0901 293 2020 or text F1 followed by your answer of A, B, or C to 63337. Calls cost a pound, texts also cost a pound, plus the standard network rate, and lines close this coming Thursday.
Thank you, Ted. It is 27 degrees where we're standing here in the paddock. On the track, it's 41 degrees, Tony. Not the sort of weather you'd choose for a jog round, but a pal of ours, Bob McKenzie, F1 rider of the Daily Express, he's had to run round here because last year he said, I will run round Silverstone naked if McLaren Mercedes win a Grand Prix, and they won in Spa.
I know, he was forced into doing this. There's his daughter, Lee McKenzie, who works for us and does our GP2 coverage. There's a strategically placed sporran from the Scotsman McKenzie.
Come on.
Well, I think he's very aerodynamic. Look at him. A great friend of ours. At least he carried out the bet, and he was forced to do that by Bernie Eccleston and, of course, Ron Dennis. Well done, Bob, I say. I wouldn't do it.
Oh. All for charity as well, Mark. Any views on that particular chassis?
I thought the Sparrow maybe was a bit big, Jim, but there you go.
OK, well, Ron Dennis said he wasn't going to be vindictive. He did allow Bob McKenzie to keep his shoes on for that particular effort. Well done to him, 3.1 miles round Silverstone. Let's go back to Ted and a couple of star guests.
Well, this is an interview I never thought I'd do, so Jackie Stewart and should-be Sir Roger Daltrey. But, Jackie, if I can just turn to you first. How do you think Silverstone's responded? It's a different kind of feeling after the events in London.
I think it's been a fantastic event. I think people have responded so positively. It's a typical example of Britain getting over a major problem and something that was so very sad. And here we've got a full house, the weather's wonderful, and it's going to be a good British Grand Prix.
The best thing Formula One can do is just put on a great race, entertain everyone?
Well, I think so. I mean, you can't ever get over the problems that we had on Thursday, but you have to get the spirits up. Motor racing used to experiencing sad moments, but you've got to get up and get on with life. And everybody here's, I think, fully respective of what's happened, but they're here to see a major event.
And Roger, what do you make of all this? I mean, you were fantastic, I must say, at Live 8 the other day. It was brilliant, but how does it compare to here?
It makes rock and roll look positively primitive. It frightens me to death. And they're louder than us.
That's if you can hear them. You've still got your hearing left.
I've got a little bit left, and that's why I bought these, because I want to keep what I've got left.
OK, thanks very much.
Exciting.
It is. Great to see you both. Thank you.
Well, up above us, the Red Arrows display team, an essential ingredient on race day here at Silverstone. They've been around for a while, since 1965, in fact. Their aerobatics never ceased to draw a gasp from the crowd, and Martin managed to hitch a precious ride.
The Red Arrows are a British institution, and we're very proud of them. This year is their 40th anniversary. They're synonymous, too, of course, with the British Grand Prix. Today's display will be their 27th here at Silverstone. They've invited me along to have a test flight to understand the challenges they face when they're flying in close formation. The test flight took place at the Red Arrows base at Scampton in Lincolnshire. First, they wanted to check me over for good health and condition. With an all clear, it was the big fit out for overalls, life jacket, boots, and a very precise fit for the helmet, mask, and goggles. On the right, team leader and Red One, Dickie Petunas, would captain my plane. Steve Underwood on the left, Red 10, would pilot the chase plane.
They take off. Surface wind 2006 knots, barrier.
Both airborne gear and flap travelling. You look at the camera now, you can give a wave, yeah? That is total trust and belief. That's like going into the first corner with 20 other Grand Prix drivers and hope they're going to get it all right.
Now we'll just get down to 100 feet and we'll just come past the tower at 100. You can see there's a bit more speed now.
So 500 miles an hour, 100 feet. Now we're pulling into...
Well, just a gentle turn, just 3.5 G. OK, I'm going to flip upside down and we'll be hanging our straps at minus 1 G in a second.
OK.
You ready?
Yeah.
Check the seat belts.
That's fast.
Okay. And here we are. You can look out your left-hand side. See the aircraft? Happy with that?
No, no, your seatbelts have to be tight.
There you go.
Wow.
Roll with him in formation, so barrel roll. And roll.
Oh, beautiful.
It's all very gentle from this cockpit, as you can imagine, though. Yeah. There's sometimes three and four aircraft out, and it gets very, very violent.
Yeah.
And the roll is actually very rapid out there, even though it's very slow here.
Yeah. Yeah, they've got to move a lot faster. I hadn't fully appreciated the three-dimensional aspect of being so accurate, the controls of an aeroplane.
Absolutely. What I have to do is I have to position the whole formation down to 300 feet in front of the crowd in exactly the right place.
Yeah. Yeah, the crowd doesn't look very big from up here, I'd imagine.
No, it doesn't. Under Luke. And pulling.
Nice, that's just 3.5G and that still hurts.
Soon the display will pull up to 8G at various points.
Yeah.
And obviously, you know, when there are lots of aircraft around, it's all very, very different.
Yeah.
See the smoke, you look. Below us, that's our smoke trail. And if I do a decent loop, I should fly back through my smoke trail the other side.
Yeah, but that's not easy to do, is it? Fly back through your own smoke to get that accuracy.
Okay, I'm going to teach you to fly now, Martin.
Okay.
Okay, if you follow me through,
yeah.
We're going to do a rapid roll to the left, okay?
Okay.
And I'm just going to plant the stick, basically. And I'll do it on 3, 2, 1. 3, 2, 1, roll. And then we'll just roll out there.
Yeah.
If you want to repeat that,
okay.
You have control.
I have control. 3, 2, 1, roll. Well, that wasn't anything that hard enough, was it?
Yeah, you're
much too gentle.
All the way to your leg, just slam it in until it goes no further,
okay.
And then try and stop with the wings level for the far side. Oh, that's better. Good man. Good.
Oh, yeah, that was a nice one.
Yeah, happy with that.
Yeah. Well, what a thrilling ride to experience the similarities between a racing car and a fighter jet. Never cease to amaze me. The pilot, the racing driver, the team behind him. Red Arrows have 100 people to create the 78 displays they'll be doing around the world this year. I see other display teams around the world as I travel with the Grand Prix Circus. And they're just not a patch. And now I can see the accuracy and the skill with which they fly the Red Arrows. We're proud of them all around the world, and so we should be.
That's one for the family album. Our thanks to the Red Arrows for that. Now we're going to talk to the Red Baron, to Michael Schumacher. You know, he left Silverstone last year after his 10th victory with 100 points in the bag. This year, Ferrari have managed just the one win, and a pretty embarrassing one at that at Indianapolis. Some of the fans pelting the drivers, and just listen to their embarrassment.
So I'll bring the trophy to each of you.
Should we go there?
Well, Michael Schumacher's only just made the top 10 this afternoon. I asked him to pinpoint the differences between F1 2005 and that magnificent seventh World Championship year.
Well, the only one is that we have been obviously winning almost permanently last year, and this year we struggled to win. We won one race, which I don't think you want to call it a normal race. This is the contrast, but that's competition. We knew it could happen. We weren't looking for it, but that's the way things can turn around very quickly, one or the other way. And because of it, we know we can turn it around to our advantage in the future again.
Do you still believe that you have a realistic chance of retaining your world title?
It's obviously much smaller than in any other of the last five seasons, no worries, and this is pretty clear, but there's no reason to yet give up.
Without going into the politics of it, how embarrassed were you about what happened in the United States?
I wasn't really that embarrassed. I mean, I think it was pretty straightforward. Tires weren't safe enough to run, so the guys couldn't run. The race wasn't a normal race, but if those guys can't race, then what can you do? I mean, we can't do really much about that.
But when you took the checkered flag there, there was a remarkable or a noticeable lack of emotion from your point of view, lack of joy.
There is no reason to celebrate your first victory if it happens under those circumstances. I see it very simple. And again, one part has made a mistake. We're all human, we do mistakes. And the consequence was seven teams couldn't race. So what is it? That's all that happened.
Let's talk about Silverstone and your emotions, really, coming to Silverstone, particularly after what happened to you here in 1999.
Well, I mean, 99 is so long ago, I don't really think much of that. I think of races I won here, good races I've driven, different races due to weather condition, the race I won through the pit lane. So there has been quite a few things going on.
I was going to say, things do tend to happen to you at Silverstone, don't they?
In one or another way, but then there's other races it does happen too. I mean, it's not just Silverstone.
I know, Michael, it's not your favourite circuit, but it is a circuit that tends to give us exciting racing. Would you agree with that?
It's one of a very traditional racing circuit. We have great fans here, great supporters, and I'm a bit sorry for them that we don't have more overtaking spots in a country where motor racing has such a heart.
Could I talk to you about your two biggest rivals? First of all, Fernando Alonso. What have you made of his achievements this season?
It's no secret that he has a very high talent. And the main thing is he understands how to make his car suiting his style to get the best performance out of it.
Do you think Kimi, at the moment, has the best overall package to work with this weekend?
In a way, he certainly has, but for whatever reason, they struggle to always give him the opportunity to prove that.
What were your emotions last weekend when you did well? You were on the podium, but you were over a minute behind the leader.
I don't see the minute, because I have been stuck most of the race behind some people. I see much more the fact that I was pretty confident before that weekend that we would seriously fight for the win. But after the race, it was very obvious that we were nowhere near that.
And the whole Ferrari team, is the motivation there as high this season as it has been throughout the winning season? Has it made you stronger, perhaps?
In a way, yes. I mean, we have been living such a good life, and we don't really enjoy where we're in. So we're working very hard to come back where we have been.
You want to get that winning feeling again?
Absolutely, that's what it is about Formula One.
Never write him off, he is ninth on the grid this afternoon. We can have a word with David Coulthard's boss now. He's called Christian Horner, top man at Red Bull Racing.
Yes, Jim, and there is David Coulthard. Newly signed David Coulthard for 2006 will stay at Red Bull Ferrari. Christian, why did you want to re-sign him? He's getting on a bit.
Well, I mean, David's still very much performing, you know, for us. He's done a fantastic job this season. You know, very nearly had two podiums. On a Sunday afternoon, he's as good as anybody out there. And it was a very logical decision for us to re-sign him for 2006.
Okay, thanks very much. Have a good race.
He's done a super job, hasn't he, David? Good to see him back with us for another year.
I think DC has done a tremendous job, and it's great that we've got him back in Formula One, but, you know, he's a changed man. He's really enjoying his motor racing again.
What do you make of Michael Schumacher's demeanour here this weekend, then, Tony?
He's miserable, absolutely miserable. I mean, Ross Brawn admitted in the press conference on Friday that we misinterpreted the regulations. I think they're missing key staff like Nicholas Tombassi from Aerodynamics that's gone across. And then you've got things like the left rear tyre. They put 3 PSI too much in it, which, of course, caused big problems in his qualifying run. Little mistakes, little cracks appearing. He's not happy at all.
You remember his elation last year, Mark? All smiles, that big leaper on the podium. Is he a totally changed guy this time, then?
I think you're just seeing a Michael Schumacher now who doesn't have the right equipment underneath him to get the job done. And you're seeing an element of frustration in him and the team. And they're all trying to get back to where they want to belong, and that's winning races, but it ain't happening.
We have to point out he has crept up to third in the Drivers' Championship as the reigning world champion, Michael Schumacher. 5 behind Raikkonen, 29 adrift of the runaway leader, Fernando Alonso. Lives nearby in Oxford, by the way. Trulli is just a couple clear of Barrichello, then Heidfeld and Weber, Ralph Schumacher, Silverstone lover Fisichella, and David Coulthard. We're going to go now to Louise, who is with some of those pilots on the Drivers' Parade.
As you can hear, that is just a fantastic response from all the fans here at the circuit. Let's just go and grab a word with some of the drivers, see what they think. David, is it always like this on the Drivers' Parade?
No, things are looking up now you're here. But
I was talking about the atmosphere, not the company.
Oh, no, this is fantastic atmosphere, really great. And fair play to the British fans. They're really putting on a big show there with all their horns and their flags. So this is probably the biggest support we've had this year.
Jensen's obviously starting from the front row of the grid. How do you think he's going to get on?
Well, I think he's obviously done a great job in qualifying. There's probably some cars that are a little bit quicker in race trim, but he's got a good chance of being on the podium. Who knows if something happens up front, he could win this.
Right, I'm going to ask him how he thinks you're going to get on now. Okay. Follow me, where's Jensen? Jensen, sorry to interrupt you. David's just been telling me how he thinks you're going to get on. How do you think he's going to get on? He said you wouldn't know where he qualified.
Was he 13th?
Yes.
Yay. I heard him saying that the worst thing is he's starting behind Mark and he's going to hold him up. I think that's all he said to me so far.
This is fantastic, isn't it?
It is. It's great to see. The only other Grand Prix I've seen this busy is Barcelona, so it's great to see so many fans here. It's good.
And they're all, not all, but a lot of them cheering for you. The pressure's on you, actually. Are you a bit nervous about it?
No. I think I'm strong enough to take it. I think I'll be all right.
It is a flawless July afternoon. The race will be off in just over 20 minutes' time. Silverstone, a 100,000 sellout. The crowd all in. No significant traffic problems reported. The roads look pretty clear from my helicopter view a little bit earlier on. Umbrellas up to keep the sun away, just like Australia. Hey, Webbo. Jenson Button is going to be starting his 92nd Grand Prix. He is 25, and that first win for Jensen is long overdue, but beware the Renaults, beware Fernando Alonso, the pole sitter here today. And it has its critics, this place, Tony. There was a doubt about whether there would be a Grand Prix for months. It fought to survive. It's great that we are here and racing Fisichello and the chaps have arrived.
I think it's a huge relief for everybody involved, from the BRDC, even the FIA as well. The circuit has just been voted the third most popular in the FIA survey amongst all the fans. And last night, the campsites were all full, the fans were all flocking here. It's a huge success, and I'd say this is the first of a five-year deal. Very relieved to get it, and hope we have a great Grand Prix.
Yeah, good weather for all those campers who have suffered here in the past. Juan Pablo Montoya will be starting the British Grand Prix third on the grid.
Well, Juan Pablo, the leading McLaren driver on the grid. Everybody's been saying that McLaren are going to be the team to beat this weekend, which I guess makes you the driver to beat.
Well, yeah, you know, the race is very long. Safety cars has been here the last 2 years, so that could be a big factor. And, you know, Kimi back there could, you know, play into his hands completely. We'll have to wait and see. You know, we're doing the best we can. I think where we are, we've got a good chance of winning. But, you know, we haven't even started the race, so it's a bit early to talk about winning.
Talk about strategies instead, then. Do you expect to see a mix of strategies today, or everybody pretty much doing the same thing?
I would be surprised. You know, I think most of the people were doing the same thing. We're probably going to be running a little bit later than most of the people.
Have a good race.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, watch out for Juan Pablo. He has a very good record here at Silverstone. Let's go down to the sharp end of that grid. There's your man, Martin.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the grid. You should be here. There's so much excitement. We've got the band of Her Royal Majesty's Royal Marines here, and they're firing up every so often. Let's head into the grid. Fantastic crowd. When Jenson Button cruised into his slot, they absolutely erupted down here. There's a lady on this grid I want to try and find first, Dame Ellen MacArthur. I've met a lot of very famous people on this grid, and I'm so looking forward to meeting her. Dame Ellen, ITV, good to see you. By the way, happy birthday for a couple of days ago.
Oh, thank you.
Now, is this your first time on a Formula One grid? Have you seen Formula One cars angry and in action before?
I was here last year. It was my first Grand Prix, and Renault invited me back again this year. And it's just great to be here. I mean, the atmosphere is extraordinary.
Yeah, so you know all about the energy and the speed of these things. But this race is going to be over in about an hour and a half, which kind of underwhelms you, I'd imagine, after a 74-day attempt.
Well, it's a bit different, I guess, but you know, those guys, their minds must already be out there. I can kind of understand that. It may be shorter, but you've still got to have so much concentration.
What sort of top speed would you get up to as you're going around the world?
Oh, 36 knots, which is not far from 36 miles an hour, so nowhere near as fast as this.
Yeah, but at least their track's going to be in the same place every lap when they come around, isn't it? Who are you here with today? Who are you supporting?
I'm here with Renault. We've been working with them for just over 2 years now, and I came here with them last year, so it's great to be back here again, and with a car in pole position, we couldn't wish for more.
So you're looking for Fisichella and particularly Alonso then, that's who you're hoping for the win today?
That's right, I was talking to them both earlier and wish them all the best.
Have you experienced anything like, obviously in racing conditions where you've got a, you know, you've got this energy at the start of an event where you have to just keep your head cool and all that, or are you always thinking longer term?
You always have to think ahead. I think these guys will be thinking, what's it going to be like on the track? How's it going to be? They'll be thinking through the race. And this part's kind of automatic pilot. You have to go through it because you have to go through it. But it's not the bit they're waiting for. They're waiting for that gun and they'll be off.
Great pleasure to meet you. Enjoy the Grand Prix. Thank you very much. Now, I'm not sure Jenson Button is back on the grid. He's not. He wandered off and he's coming back very short. I can see him wandering. Dan, let's go and meet him at the gate and walk back with him. Hello, Patrick. Because we want to just try and grab a quick word. We're going to go back through the band, but I think that's our best shot of seeing what, short of going to the toilet door, that is. Jens, I thought this might be the best chance. We've spoken to you plenty today, but this is it. Yeah, this is the final moment. The crowd went mad. The musicians are playing. You look pretty cool, though.
I feel pretty relaxed. Yeah, nice to be on the front row and... yeah, I'm looking forward to the race.
Extra pressure here with all the home fans and all that. Have you managed to? I mean, you tried to knock that off and get it off your back earlier in the week, saying I've got no chance here. But here you are on the front row.
Yeah, it's looking okay. But I mean, you don't feel the pressure when you're driving anyway. You're just so focused. But it's great to have so many supporters here. I mean, it's just packed the grandstands, which is great to see. So yeah. Loads of Union Jacks as well, which is nice.
Yeah, you see them during the race, don't you? You see the faces turning with you and you see the flags waving and it just gives you some energy.
It does.
You seem remarkably calm. I'm super impressed. I'm going to let you get in the car. Let's wander off and see who else we can find. Could be a short and sweet grid walk today because there's going to be a national anthem and then a minute's silence to remember the terrible events of London this week. Let's see who else we could find. David Richards. David, quick word. How's it feel to be back on the Formula One grid, but not really directly involved with the team?
I'm having a quiet day with all my friends today, so I'll be in the bar of the BRDC listening to you instead.
Okay, well, good. Hopefully we'll be talking some...
might see a British win today, who knows?
Well, Jensen's got to have half a chance, hasn't he, if he can get ahead of Alonso into the first turn.
Well, I think that's the key, and of course Montoya is going to be tricky as well, so let's wait and see, but certainly on the podium.
Thanks, DR. See you. Right. Rubens, I think, is standing down here looking... looking almost lonely down here. If we can get a quick word with him before this lady starts. Sorry. Rubinho, a quick word for British TV. What's any chance today? Your tyres, they look like they were going away a bit towards the end of the quali lap. Are they going to hang on a bit better through the Grand Prix?
Well, we had a consistent run yesterday, very consistent. So our only chance is at the end of the race. I think the tyres are coming back. Michelin is looking the same way. If that's what it is, McLaren and Renault are going faster than us.
So you think there's going to be two or three phases to this Grand Prix then for all the tyre runners? Whichever tyre runner you're out with?
Well, it's our Bridgestone for sure have a little problem at the beginning, but it's consistently getting better. So that's our hope. I mean, that at the end of the race, we have a better tyre than the others.
Okay, good luck. You're normally a bit of a specialist around here. I think it's a good time to go back to Jim.
Well done down there, Martin. Rubens Barrichello had a brilliant win here a couple of years ago. One of the drives of his career. David Richards, ex-boss at BAR, hoping for a British win. David Coulthard has won here a couple of times. His race prospects, Tony Jardine, as we take a little look at Jacques Villeneuve, he's also been showing improved form. What about David? He's down the field. Can he nick a few points from there?
I think he can. It was an interesting shot there. You've got two-time winners of the British Grand Prix. You know, they've got pedigree around this place, and I think Coulthard could get into the points.
Thank you.
British Grand Prix, an essential ingredient in the British sporting summer. And the setting, it does look absolutely spectacular. And now we have a minute's silence for everyone affected by the tragic events in London. There we are, Formula One, remembering everybody touched by the bombings in London. There is Max Mosley, president of the FIA. A little word about him, Tony Jardine. He's made it clear to us he's not resigning, but he's not a popular fellow at the moment with the drivers or most of the teams in the paddock.
No, he's not. And I think what Mark and I were very worried about and the rest of Formula One is that it's driven a big wedge between the manufacturers' teams, the Gang of Seven, so-called, and the FIA, and Ferrari have sided with the FIA as well. There's Fernando Alonso, pole sitter. He's won every race from pole that he started this year. And he's looking in good shape, isn't he? Especially the work they did on the car overnight.
So, Mark, just give us your thoughts about the race. How crucial is that first corner? Who gets there first?
It's obviously the important factor. But Alonso and the Renault, we know it's a fast-starting car. They're always off the line, very good. And, you know, Alonso definitely is going to go out there and get this race under his belt. I think Montoya could be a little bit of a fly in the ointment. Jensen with a fuel load is going to be okay. But I think Raikkonen's got the tough task today. He really needs to get up and try and score some big points to go towards this World Championship.
VAR, great optimism there. And that's a little word on Ferrari. You know, Rubens Barrichello always goes pretty well here, Tony.
Well, he loves this place. You have to remember, he drove for Jackie Stewart's team. He drove in Formula 3 teams. He's done a lot of testing round here. And, of course, his sparring partner was David Coulthard when they were fighting for honours in the British Formula 3 Championship. And they've duelled around here before now. He knows every inch of Silverstone. He loves it, and he loves the fans too.
It's great, isn't it, to be saying how hot it is at Silverstone, Mark? Doesn't happen too often.
It's great. It really is fantastic. And there's a huge crowd out there. And I think all the drivers, you know, everybody, apart from the English guys especially, are enjoying this event so far.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Tony. Yep, we are racing. We are ever mindful of everyone who's been affected by the London bombs. We wonder if this man, Jenson Button, can become the first Englishman to win around Silverstone since Johnny Herbert 10 years ago. Jenson needing some of that Mansell people power from his Barmy army. Oxford resident Alonso alongside him really has top class honours so far this season. We're going to be watching for Montoya and for Trulli, and we're awaiting a surge from the back from the Iceman, Kimi Raikkonen. Believe me, it is great to be at home for the British Grand Prix.